In chapter two, we talked a lot about business processes, information systems, and what exactly is information and how is it different than data. In chapter three, what we want to do is look at the company as a whole, and particularly looking at organizational strategy and how information systems fit into that, particularly in creating competitive advantage. Now, at the beginning of chapter three, there is a ongoing case, GearUp, which is a sports site that creates little auctions to sell products that they get from vendors. And during one of their meetings, it becomes very clear that the CEO says that their strategy is to provide the absolute lowest rock bottom prices on everything they sell. Now, the CIO was trying to suggest a switching strategy, but that's a major change in how the business operates. So the CEO is like, no, we're not doing that. This is our focus. This is what we're doing. But the problem was that they're having some issues with their operating expenses. And so they're trying to find a solution, right? Figure out innovative ways to reduce costs. So some potential solutions included, but here's the thing. Before you can come up with a solution, you need to know what exactly the problem is. And so they need better data to identify problematic vendors. And this maybe will require a change in information system to automatically order and drop shipments to customers. So those are possible solutions, but they need more. They need more data, okay? But what this scenario highlighted was that it's important to understand your industry and your particular competitive strategy within that industry. And you need to be able to consider the risks of changing in operations to stay competitive and understand how information systems and information systems can help inform a decision, particularly even at a strategic level. So that's kind of the overall goal of this chapter was, number one, how does organizational strategy determine information systems requirements? And then we're going to walk through a bit of strategy and talk about what are the five forces that determine industry structure, what is a competitive strategy, how does competitive strategy determine the value chain structure, and how do value chains determine business processes, heading back to chapter two, and information systems. And lastly, how do information systems provide competitive advantages? All right. So we're going to take and look a little bit higher level than what we did in the last chapter. So we got the business processes. We kind of got a little grasp of what that is and how information systems can help with that. Now we're going to look at it from the entire organizational standpoint. So let's get in, dig into question one. How does organizational strategy determine information systems requirements? It's a mouthful, right? Well, it starts with really trying to understand your industry, okay? And to do this, now there is a very popular, well-known methodology for doing this, which is looking through Porter's five forces. And we'll explain that here in a second. Now, Porter was a very famous strategy professor from, I believe it was Harvard, and he developed what he called the five forces model, which is a way to understand the industry and where you fit within it. Secondly, once you have your industry structure, you can develop a competitive strategy within that industry. Third, once you understand your competitive strategy, you can start developing your value chains. This is the chain of how you keep adding value to your business. So that way you start with these raw materials and you end up with this fantastic product that people want. So value chains lead to business processes lead to information systems. Now, one thing I do want to say real quick here is that the book approaches this in a very top-down manner. And I don't necessarily agree that this is the best way to do this, because sometimes, and this does happen often enough, that new information technology inspires new information systems, which inspires new business processes, which inspires new value chains, competitive strategies, and industry structures. that can happen. And a lot of times what good CEOs will do will be they'll be constantly monitoring changes in the industry, not just changes in industry, but changes in technology that will enable new things to develop. And so over time, because of new technology, they may be able to change their competitive strategy. And indeed, sometimes new technologies will change the entire industry structure. So when you're thinking about this, also realize that it can go both ways. Okay. And in fact, a good business, if they want to stay around for the long term, is going to be constantly looking at how they can innovate within their industry in order to stay relevant. All right, let's dig into Porter's five forces. What five forces determine industry structure? Well, really, he looks at two main areas, competitive forces and then bargaining forces. So what are the three main competitive forces? Number one, there's a competition from vendors of substitute products. So let's say, for example, you decide to go into the market to sell soccer balls. Right? You're selling soccer balls. That's your thing. You love soccer. And so you're gonna, I'm gonna sell soccer balls. Well, that's great. You can sell all the soccer balls you want. But people may decide they don't want to play soccer, they want to play basketball, or they want to play baseball, or some other sport, or maybe no sport at all. Maybe they decide, well, forget sports, let's start playing video games. And then I can just play it on there. And that's the And oftentimes, when you're doing a competitive analysis, that's oftentimes missed, is looking at substitute products. And this can be something, too, that I've seen in industry where, you know, people talk about, well, this one company has a monopoly on the mining of tin, let's say. I'll just throw out tin as a metal, right? Well, tin is a good product, is a good metal for doing some things with. But that doesn't mean, so we used to have things called tin cans. What now today? People can use alternative metals other than tin to create cans. So just because you used to be able to do something, you can use substitutes. And so the mining company that used to create tin may not stay competitive if someone comes along that can manufacture, let's say, aluminum cans cheaper than what you're currently doing. All right, second, new competitors. Right? What's the competition from new competitors? These are people that could enter into this marketplace and start selling goods. You know, what's the cost for them to do so? Now, what we saw in the 1990s and early 2000s, particularly in the internet, was that there were millions of new competitors. There was such a low cost of cost barrier to get in and create a website and start selling goods online that millions of businesses were created to do this. In fact, there's still thousands, if not millions, of new companies that are emerging online all the time. Okay. So whatever industry you're in, that's something you have to take a very big picture. Take a good look at is saying, how easy is it for a new company to come in and start competing? Now, as the internet develops, it becomes harder and harder, though. So if you wanted to become the low-cost provider of goods on an internet, so say the low-cost provider of books, right? How easy will that be? Well, now it's actually very difficult because there already is one company that dominates the marketplace, and they have so many great relationships with the book industry, that it would be very difficult to compete. And of course, that company is Amazon, right? So if you wanted to sell books online, one of your major competitors would be Amazon, and it'd be very, very, very hard to be competitive against them. And we'll talk a little bit about how you could do that, but at this point, just keep that in mind. And then you also have competition from existing rivals. So these are companies that already exist, already in your industry, selling the same thing that you're selling, right? Now that's the most obvious, visible one. And so some people will focus a little bit too much, too heavily on that. But yes, that is important. But you also need to be aware of the other two. OK, competitive forces. The last area is the bargaining power of various people, including your customers and your suppliers. So this might mean how, you know, if you're a small niche company, how much power would you have bargaining with your suppliers? Probably not much, because the suppliers would be like, eh, you know what? You don't buy that much from us, so we're not going to give you great deals. Whereas our big, powerful customers, those are the people that we do want to cater to, right? Now, an example of this might be like the car industry. The big three, Chrysler, I guess, got bought out by some European company with a Fiat. We have General Motors and Ford. Well, they became so big and powerful that they control they have a huge bargaining power over their suppliers. And a lot of the suppliers, and you know, I used to live in Michigan, so I saw this firsthand, but their suppliers, you know, they would dictate oftentimes how much they could pay the employees of in their suppliers' companies. I mean, that's how much power those big three auto companies had, right? So all these, you know, so the companies, you know, they might make seats for the car companies, or they might make dashboards, or they might make the drivetrain, you know, whatever different parts they're making. But these suppliers had a very low bargaining power. And then the flip side of that is, what's the bargaining power of your customers? So again, this might be something that you're... customers have a lot of strength, can have a lot of control over what you do, in particular if it's a major customer. So sometimes you'll have one customer who's 20% of your business. What would be their bargaining power? Probably pretty strong, because if you lost 20% of your business, what would that mean to your business? Usually it's a huge, huge impact. So something you have to be very, very aware of in how you develop your competitive strategy. So here's what the five forces and gear up might look like, all right? So, and you can follow through this with, in your book as well. So looking at the type of, competitive strength, so looking at substitutes, right? What is gear up's strength assessment? Well, you know, if you're into sporting goods, well, it'd be very hard to really, sporting goods usually have a very set of things that you need, right? So each sport. So in that case, you know, substitutes, well, you can switch to different sports, but it's a moderate switching cost. Once you're into a sport, you're tending to stick in that sport. You don't usually switch too often. Some people do, you know, they'll play soccer for a few years, but then they might switch to baseball. But the cost of carrying inventory and of the retail space should mean higher prices than gear up. So substituting and using retail stores isn't always that easy. What about new entrants? Well, gear up is already, it sounds like they've already established a fairly strong competitive marketplace. They're developed, they have relationships with their vendors. So new entrants, they could come in and do this, but it's not going to be easy, right? There's also customers are moderately loyal to gear up. There are some capital requirements to build an entire website, that e-commerce website, to do all this stuff. They also have the knowledge of vendors and the vendor relationships. That does create some barriers to entry. It can be overcome, but it does set something up, right? Now, where GearUp has the strongest competitive strength is within their current rivalries with other sporting goods companies. So price, quality, innovation, and marketing, they're doing well at. There's very low switching costs. Customers moderately loyal to GearUp. Customers influenced by price, quality, innovation and marketing, but the rivals, you know, they have established themselves as the lowest price company, which makes them very hard to be competitive with. Whereas for substitutes, yes, you can easily substitute. When it comes to rivals, they're dominating. And so they're doing a really good job there. So the strength assessment is strong. What about their bargaining power? Now, it sounds like with their vendors, they have a moderate level of bargaining power with their suppliers. Tend to be seasonal and brand cycles, which ensure vendor access, which they can then tap into the vendor access inventory. GearUp must be competition to it, though. So there is some competition to get to the vendors and get the information, especially these access inventories that they can get at a real low price. Now, with the customers, they also have a very strong competitive force. The customers, tend to be making up much more impulse buys. Most purchases are elective, so the customers, they can't really bargain very well with GearUp to get what they want, right? Which gives more power to GearUp, more strength. All right, so what does that mean? Well, let's start talking. Let's transition now from these competitive forces and look at the competitive strategy. So what can you do with this? Well, and again, Porter actually came up with this too as well. Brilliant guy. Porter's four competitive strategies. And he basically said there's two ways to break this down. There's the breadth of your product and service offerings versus how you're going to try to be different, which is your cost, or you're going to compete by cost, or you're going to compete by differentiating yourself from the other people, versus how much stuff are you going to carry? Are you going to try to compete in an entire industry or focus on one particular product, which is more of a focus? So for like in the top box, the lowest cross across the industry, right? A great example of this would be Walmart. Walmart does a phenomenal job at being the lowest cost across the industry. Now you might say, well, you may not like going to Walmart. You might, maybe you do. Maybe you like saving all the money. Maybe you don't like going there. But that's their strategy. And it's very, very clear what that strategy is. What might be an industry-wide differentiation might be some of the department stores that you go to, right? Sears or JCPenney. You might even call Target. They're a bit more on the low-cost side, but they also try to differentiate themselves from Walmart. So it's and then the, so you can kind of see that's kind of a continuum here. It's not necessarily one or the other. You can have fairly low cost, but you still try to differentiate yourself from the low cost leader. What about someone who wants to focus on cost, but in a specific focal area? Well, this might be someone like, well, I think a good example of this might be, I started with Amazon when they started selling just books. So way, way, way back in 1995. 96, when they were just selling books, right? That was the only product that they were selling. But they were the low-cost leader in that area. Now, over time, they kept adding more and more products, and they basically became an industry-wide low-cost leader. So they moved in that same competitive category as Walmart. But when they first started, they had a focus just on books. Another example might be something like Old Navy. Old Navy, again, they focus just on clothing, but they try to keep their prices really, really low. All right, let's talk about differentiation. Who might be an industry-wide but tries to differentiate itself? Okay, we talked a little bit about, the department stores. They definitely try to go for that differentiation that sets them apart. But they're also industry-wide in what they all sell, all different types of retail products. Differentiation versus focus. Well, this, walk through a mall, and I'd say about 90% of the boutiques in the mall, all those little stores, have a tight focus on their product line with very differentiated from everybody else. They don't try to be low cost, but oftentimes they have different or better products. They try to compete by service, all within an industry segment, right? So what this does, though, is by defining your competitive strategy, how are you going to try to make yourself different than everybody else, whether it's through cost or through having a better product or service? And then say, how focused are you going to be? Now you can move. Like I said, Amazon moved. They started with a focus on cost in a particular product, and then they moved into a much wider area. So it's not saying you can't change a competitive strategy, but usually once you develop a competitive strategy, you're going to hammer in on that strategy as long as you can. And by doing that, that's going to define your value chain. So this is where your business is creating value for your customers. Now, and this is when they use the term value here, and I find this in a lot of business books, which I think is rather unfortunate. They focus only on monetary value, as in the cost. Now, they don't always say that, but value can be a much broader concept than that. Because some people, especially when if you want to get a little philosophical about it, you can say in ethical terms, there's a concept called value. What are your values? I value a world where people respect each other. So it can be broader, and I think that can be an impact on how people view a company. Do you want to work, do you want to buy products from a company that is, respects their customers in a very deep way, or one that treats the customers as a way to make money, right? When you hear the term value, and it's, I think, rather unfortunate to do this, they try to monetize it all. It can be much broader than that. Because to me, a business is all about creating value, not just monetary value, but value for people to flourish in their life, right? And that's why one of the things I think businesses are freaking amazing at doing this, their singular purpose is creating value for people. Now, if you can look at value in a little broader sense than just money and see value as we're creating, some sort of ethical value for people to flourish, well, businesses then become this, wonderful tool for improving the world. Okay. I know it's getting a little probably too touchy-feely for some of you guys, but consider that though, because I think it can have an impact, big impact on how you view competitive strategy and how you view business. All right. But let's say that we do monetize it, right? So it's the amount of money that a customer is willing to pay. Now, the idea behind this is, let's say, so consider this. How much money, and this is one way to kind of conceptualize this value, how much money would you be willing to accept to not have access to the internet? In other words, if someone were to say, how much would I have to pay you to not use the internet ever again? Now think about that for a while, right? Think about all the things you would have to give up not to have access to the internet. Now you might say, well, I could hire somebody to do all that, or I could, I mean, there's a lot of things you could play around with here. But the idea is, though, when you talk about value, the amount of money that a customer is willing to pay, and some things, like the internet, are extremely valuable to people. How much money? So personally, if you asked me, how much money would I have to accept? Well, honestly, the internet is how I make money, right? That's my job. Is all of, I primarily teach web development, but information systems in general, and I love teaching online, like I'm doing right now with you guys. So not only would I have to give up basically my entire career, but I would have to give up doing something that I really love. So how much money would it take? Well, basically, you'd have to give me enough money that I could find a new career that I loved. So you're talking millions of dollars. So how much do I pay for the internet? Well, right now, what? Well, at work, I pay nothing. At home, I pay $50 a month. So the entire value to me, so the marginal value of the internet is immense. It's huge, monstrous, right? But this gets to the point of the value chain. And this is true of a lot of products, right? So you say, what's the value of a bicycle to you? And depending on how much you ride it and how much you enjoy it, there's an enjoyment that you get out of it, right? So though that's your value. So how much does it cost? And is the cost less than the value? Usually speaking, if the value you gain from it is less than the cost, there's no margin to it and people won't do it. But that can vary depending on how much money you have too. But the value chain, so within a business though, we can start doing a little better calculations about this. So that would be describe in an organization as a chain or series of processes, the business processes, right? Each of which can either add or reduce the value provided to the customer. And so what you want is to have a value chain that keeps adding value to a product or service so that by the time the customer, by so coming from your raw materials, by the time you get to the customer, there's a great increase in the value. And this what it would look like. So let's suppose, so here's another example. Food at the grocery store. Now, a lot of you could grow your own food some way, right? Now, maybe you're living in an apartment, so what you would have to do is rent some land from somebody else to grow your own garden. But what is the value of being able to go to the store and buy that? Well, what would be the alternative cost if you had to rent some land? And then you have to include the time it would take to grow all that stuff. The fact that sometimes, some years, that you wouldn't grow nearly as much as you want to because of the weather. You'd have to buy, special fertilizers, or maybe you have to buy or go through and weed the garden. So there's a lot of time, a lot of effort. Is it cheaper for you? Is there a marginal value to you by going to the grocery store to buy that? And so then what the grocery store can do is say, we can look at each part of our process to help bring down that cost for you. Or perhaps increase the value. Which consider this. If you had your own garden, could you have the same variety of products that they have in a grocery store? Most likely not, because you can't grow things here like oranges or bananas. I mean, I guess you could have a greenhouse, but again, if you're in an apartment, you can't, right? So that's kind of the idea here behind this value chain, is that each step of the process. So what a grocery store can then look at is, where can I get products from? So the variety of food, and sometimes even the production of different kinds of food. So not just the raw food, you can get your vegetables and fruits and meats and milk and cheese. But even things that are more processed, noodles or breakfast cereals, sodas. So a huge, huge variety of things. But you can buy things cheaply at different sources. You can arrange them in the store in such that it's easier for people to find what they're looking for, so it takes them less time to get what they need. I mean, there's an entire process here, right? And that's what I'm talking about, the business processes, right? So each of these parts requires the ability to add value to the customer. So in the book, I have a bicycle maker's value chain. So this starts with an acquire bicycle parts, produce the bicycle, ship the bicycles, market and sell the bicycles, and then even service the customers after they have received their bicycles. So that's what's above the line. Then below this little red line, lists a set of I'm sorry, the top line is the primary activities. Underneath are the kind of secondary or support activities. So you need to be able to manage your supplier relationships. You need to be able to innovate new designs, or maybe you need information systems, or maybe you need human resources to deal with your employees, or maybe you need to manage company resources through accounting and finance. These are all support activities to the business. Now, if you look at this entire thing here, you're basically seeing a lot of the major degrees that go through a business program, right? We have supply chain management, you have marketing, you have accounting and finance, information systems, management as far as human resources, and even procurement. They're all integrated into this together. At each one of these parts, we can add value, a marginal value to a product, assuming we add value over and above the cost. Now, it's possible you're not doing that. There can be at certain parts in the process where the cost is greater than the value added. And this isn't always easy to calculate, because again, value is not always really clear. It's more of a subjective evaluation. And maybe it'll add value to some customers, but not to others. But overall, what you're trying to achieve is to increase the total overall margin, both from the primary activities and your support activities, so that your customers will want to buy your products. And the greater total margin you can offer, the better. So here's a little bit more detailed of all the different activities. So you have inbound logistics, which is receiving, storing, and disseminating inputs to the product. You have operations, so what's going on internally in the business, and the manufacturing, the creating, the putting the pieces together. You have outbound logistics, sending the products back out. This might even be packing in it, and what type of packing material you're using, who you're using to ship your stuff with, having a warehouse to ship that stuff out in as efficient a manner as possible. You have sales and marketing, which is your effort to actually induce buyers to purchase the product and provide a means for them to do so. And then after they have bought the product, we have to assist the customers to use the product, to understand if they have problems, help them fix it, help them understand how to use it well. Anything that you can do at this point can enhance the product's value, because good customer service does tend to make customers happier. Right? And hopefully you've all had experiences with that, where you've had good customer service. Where you've had bad customer service that usually leaves a foul taste in your mouth, right? Or no customer service. You know, for example, this past winter, I received a little fire pit for my backyard, and there was missing a handle on the screen cover on it. So I emailed the company and said, "Hey, I just recently got this product. It's actually a Christmas present. It's missing the top handle on the screen." And so I'm expecting them to send me just the little handle. Instead, what I got in the mail was the entire new screen. Now, I mean, it seems like a small thing, but it was actually pretty cool because they went above and beyond my expectations, and that left a very positive image in my mind. All right. So think about that. Just little things that you can do sometimes can make a big difference. All right, some of the support activities, so like technology, and the way they describe it here in the book is this: technology includes R&D, new techniques, methods, procedures. It should also include information technology. They're not real specific on that in here, but yes, that should be included in there. Procurement, your raw materials. So how do you get your raw materials? Where? What are the sources? The quality of it. Managing that process. Human resources, so the training, recruiting, and compensation of employees. Making sure that your employees are happy so that they will want to do a better job. And then the overall firm infrastructure, like general management, finance, accounting, legal, government affairs, if it's necessary, and so on. So oftentimes what you'll find is that there's linkages across these different value activities. And these can be used to identify different synergies. Right? So interactions across the value activities readily supported by, guess what, information systems. Now again, these information systems may not include actual technology itself. They can be paper-based or just by word of mouth. So yes, they often are supported by this. The question is, can we use technology to make it better? So manufacturing systems use these linkages to reduce costs, again, adding value, which increases the total marginal value that's being created for your customer. So for example, we have sales forecasts used to plan production, or production plan determines the raw materials need, or the material needs used to schedule purchases. Or we can do something like what's called just-in-time inventory, which means as we know the schedule for manufacturing, we can have the materials arrive, shipped to us just in time, so we don't have to have huge warehouses of inventory. It can also be used to reduce inventory sizes and costs. So by linking all these things together, if you know your sales forecasts, you can now reduce the overall size and costs in your manufacturing. And now that's huge, right? So tying together your sales and marketing with your manufacturing and your inventory, now you've made these linkages that can improve the value or reduce the cost. In this case, it's reducing costs, right? All right, so how do value chains determine business processes and information systems? Well, value chains map business processes and allow you to visualize where data is lost or added. So it's great at helping with this visualization. That makes it possible to make resource allocation decisions. So for example, if a process is losing value, so let's say for example, you have a finance department and you're financing a new factory. Can IT help with that process so that you have the greatest impact from where you put your factory? Well, actually, yes. And we'll talk a little bit about geographic information systems and how they can be used for helping to pick where you're going to put your factory, so that you can either reduce costs or add value. So maybe you want to put your factory near your raw materials suppliers, or your material suppliers, right? Or maybe you want to make sure it's near a interstate so that it's easy to start to have your trucks get on the interstate and start traveling, or maybe near a railroad. So these are all very important considerations when you're developing or trying to pick something, right? Let's say, here's another example. If a process creates a great deal of value, can we make that process more effective or efficient? So yeah, we have a factory. And let's say in our factory, we have over 10,000 different products that could be shipped out. So every time a customer asks for something, they may ask for 20 or 30 different things that you have to go pick up out of the factory in order to ship it. What is the most efficient process for your, forklift drivers to go pick up those items? You got 20 or 30 items, you got this big, huge warehouse. How can they get those items the fastest? Can you use an information system to help with that? Especially if you have, you have hundreds of shipments going out every day, right? Maybe even thousands of shipments going out every day. maybe even hundreds of thousands of shipments going out every day. How can you develop a process that will allow you to pick up the items that you need the fastest? And can you use information systems to help with that? You know, and I actually have seen places where they did. So I was up here in Greenville, there's a company called The Hammock Source. They create a lot of hammocks, but they also do a lot of other things. And they told me that they have over 10,000 SKUs. So if you don't know what a SKU is, basically it's the individual items, right? So they have over 10,000 individual items, and not all of these are manufactured at their company. Some of it they resell from other companies. But the point it being that they had developed an information system that would allow their forklift drivers, it basically tells them where to go first, second, third, fourth to pick up all the items they need in the most efficient manner, right? So to save them money by making it faster to make the process more efficient. So you can also ask if a process either creates nor loses much value, is investing in that process smart? So maybe you have a business process. Maybe you, you own a lake where you rent out different types of, kayaks, canoes. Maybe you charge people to go swimming. So you need lifeguards to man the beach. Well, is anyone? So maybe you find out that, while having canoes and kayak rental is doesn't make much money, doesn't really lose much money, it kind of breaks even. So you've investigated the process. Is it worth investing in? And can information systems help you make that decision? Well, it might be that the people that come swim there often like to also rent the canoes and kayaks. So if you stop selling canoes and kayaks, would they go away? Well, how would you know that? Unless you're actually were able to track the individuals and what they, do. But maybe the people that come to rent the canoes and kayaks don't really spend much, don't swim. And so if you cut that part out of the business, you'd still get the same number of swimmers. And maybe that's your biggest cash flow, right? So little things like that, you can evaluate, is it worth investing in that process or not by looking at your data. So value chains are dependent on strategy, and low cost oftentimes means more focus on cost reduction, whereas differentiation means more focus on satisfaction. And so here's a couple ways you can break down, how a low cost rental to students of bicycles might look different than a high service rental of bicycles to, let's say, executives at a conference. Right. So if you want to do a low cost, you're not going to have very sophisticated information systems. Right. You're going to try to keep the price as low as you want or as you can. And so the value chain here would be all about, when you talk to you want to rent a bike, you say, hey, you want a bike? Yes. All right. They're over there. You can go help yourself. And you fill out this form, bring it to me when you're done, and you'll owe me $2,350. Done. Awesome. Okay. And maybe your supporting business systems, including your information systems, might be very minimal. All right. So physical control, maybe you just have a bike locks. You have printed forms and a shoebox to put them in. So very low cost items, right? Whereas if you're doing a high end rental service, you're probably going to have a much more sophisticated way of handling this, including keeping track of what customers have done in the past, giving them a lot more, here's a map maybe to help you or some options of where you can ride your bike. But you can see that the process here is different, right? The value chain is different because what you're trying to do is you're doing a much, yes, the costs are going up, but you're also offering much higher value to your customers. And so that's how you're going to basically differentiate these guys, right? And that's why it's important to realize the connection between this. And oftentimes when you get to these higher end value chains, you're trying to differentiate yourself. It usually takes a little bit more money, but the goal is to have a higher customer satisfaction out of it. And that's the value that's being created. So information technology can help a lot with this, right? It does create competitive advantage by allowing you to really differentiate yourself. So some examples of this. When you do something better than all of your competitors, you create better products. Or maybe you can create more revenue. Or you can lower your costs. So here's some examples of those. For a while, Google offered a free 411 service. So you can take your phone, you dial in 411, and it was entirely voice automated. And that's how they could do it for free. Now, I don't think Google does this anymore. But why would Google do that, right? So they're using information technology, though. They used it to create a competitive advantage. How? Well, after doing this for several years, they developed a lot of great voice signals and voice samples that they could use to improve their voice recognition systems. So the more that people used it, the better they were able to create voice recognition systems, and then they could apply it to their Android phones and have much better phone interaction. Now think of that, that's pretty amazing. Here's another example. FedEx, right? So back in the 90s, they did this a little trick, right? So they did track all their packages through an information technology system, right? But it was all internal, but they kept track of where the products were, at what, you know, location and on what truck. They decided to turn that system so it wasn't just visible to their internal employees, but also was available to their customers. They took the exact same information. They simply made it from an intranet, which is internal, to an internet base so that customers could see, based on their tracking number, where their product was. What did it do? Well, it actually improved the service for their customers because customers didn't have to initially call in to find out where their package was. Now all they had to do was go to the website. They don't have to deal with sitting on the phone and waiting on hold, right? It actually also had a secondary benefit, which was it lowered the costs. Because less people called in, they needed a smaller customer support service, even though they're offering a better customer service experience. So that one little flip of their IT gave them a competitive advantage because nobody else was doing that. Made a great experience. So even though FedEx, you know, they're not the low-cost leader. You know, that's the U.S. Postal Service, right? But what they did is they differentiated themselves and created a competitive advantage by doing that. Now, they were quickly copied by UPS and other shipping companies, but for a while there, they had a very unique competitive advantage. All right. So where do information systems provide competitive advantages? Well, number one, they can create a new product or service. Two, an enhanced product or service with extra systems, right? Three, it can differentiate its products or services. Four, it can lock in customers and buyers. You know, if you've created an account with a company, it's a small lock-in, but people don't want to have 10,000 different accounts, so they prefer to have fewer accounts. It can lock you into using their service more and more. Okay, it can lock in suppliers, as we'll look at supply chain management systems that can do that. It can raise barriers to market entry, because if you get so far beyond everyone else, they can't simply compete with you. It can establish alliances. So your information systems, if you start integrating your information systems with your suppliers and information systems, you create an alliance, and that can greatly improve your business. And it can just help reduce costs. So it can do it across the board, all these different possibilities. Right, and as we go through the semester, we'll talk more and more about each of these and how that can be done. So we'll reiterate these. So even though I don't go into much detail with these now, just realize we'll dig into these, right? You can also even go above and beyond that with things like business intelligence, which is knowledge about your competitors, your suppliers, your own internal operations, and even your customers. And by combining this information into different ways you can create real knowledge that you're cut that nobody can compete with, because it's your knowledge, your intelligence, your information, your data. And it encompasses everything that affects your business and helps you make strategic business decisions. It also helps with the knowledge management function. So what is knowledge management? And we're going to talk more about business intelligence and knowledge management later. I just want to give you a taste of it. But basically, realize that knowledge is a resource for your company. In fact, it is the ultimate resource, because it's about people, and the people have knowledge. Now, there's a problem with that, and that people can walk away. Now, this could just be that they change jobs, or it could be that they retire. Now, consider that the baby boomer generation is going to be retiring very, very soon, right? There's a huge segment of our population who's going to be retiring and taking a lot of knowledge out of the workforce. Now, that's a huge, huge problem for a lot of businesses, right? Excuse me. But if you have good knowledge management systems, you can help capture that knowledge, store it, make it accessible for future employees to be implementable in the future. But what I want you to do now is take some time and think about your own personal competitive advantage. All right. So a lot of you guys will be graduating soon, a couple of years. Who will be your competitors when you seek a job after graduating from college? Is it just ECU grads? No. You'll be competing from people from around the state. Is it just from around the state? Well, no, actually, the people are pretty mobile. And even if they don't want to move, there's a lot of great virtual communication systems that allow people to work at a distance. That whole telecommuting thing I talked about. Why are they surrounding the United States? In fact, what we see today is that a lot of people throughout the world can now compete for the same jobs. And that's why you're seeing, especially like in places like India, where there's a massive growth in the number of people who are doing work and facilitating that work that used to be done in the US, from customer support to information technology. Soon you're going to see even business functionality. You know, people that can do your marketing for you, or even people that can do, like I've seen examples of doctors who were actually trained and board certified here in the U.S., but they moved back to the country of their origin, whether it's India or the Philippines or Taiwan. But the cost of living is so low there that they can do their same job at a much lower cost. And because they can do it at a much lower cost, you can get the same work done by a board certified, medically trained here in the U.S., so they have all the same skill set as any doctor here, but you're basically, you go over there and get it at half the price or a quarter of the price, right? So you now have a global competitiveness when it comes to your job. What will be your competitive advantage in the job marketplace? And that's what you need to ask. What can you do before you graduate to develop your competitive advantage? And think about, how do these elements of competitive advantage apply to you? You know, what's the switching cost to change from you to some other employee? So what's going to make, what value can you add to the business that they can't get from somebody else? What differentiates you from the other candidates? Are you creating barriers of entry from other people getting in there? You know, is there something special about you that nobody else can do? Are you establishing alliances? So maybe this is working with student groups. That's an alliance, right? And you all work collectively to get jobs. Are reducing costs or increasing revenues? You know, are you willing to work for less money? Or are you adding something of value to the business that you're going to? And even think about this. How can information systems help you gain a competitive advantage? Now, one thing I do in my web development classes, and I think this is even required in the Business 3200 class, is develop a web portfolio. Now, I've seen a lot of students who really don't take full advantage of this. This can really differentiate yourself. You're using an information system, but you can use it to really differentiate yourself, and you should. All right, and think about other ways you can do that, right? And I don't want to stop there. I'm going to leave that up to your imagination. But that's what we've covered today. So number one, how does organizational strategy determine information systems requirements? Two, what five forces determine industry structure? You know, Porter's five forces. Three, what is a competitive strategy? Remember, there is the cost and differentiation versus the industry-wide or a focus. How does competitive strategy determine the value chain structure? In other words, creating value for your customers and at each step of the process, both your primary activities and your support activities. How do value chains determine business processes and information systems? So you see that each of those primary activities encompasses a business process or more one than one. And information systems can help facilitate that. In fact, the information systems can provide competitive advantages in multiple different ways. So, what can you take away from this? Information systems are an extremely powerful component in this process and can even help drive competitive strategies. So hopefully, as we continue throughout the semester, you can see ways that that can happen. And that's it for now. We'll keep moving on to chapter four next. I'm sorry, we're going to skip chapter four, because chapter four is a lot about hardware and software, which, while there's a lot of good stuff in it, tends to be a bit more technical than really what we want to cover. So we're going to skip that and go into chapter five and talk about database processing, get to the heart of the matter of databases and how they work. That's it for today, and we'll catch you next time.